إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونثوب إليه من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في الله حق جهاده فجازاه الله عنا خير الجزاء أما بعد فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هديه صلى الله عليه وسلم وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما يقول الله عز وجل في محكم كتابه بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم والضحى والليل إذا سجى ما ودعك ربك وما قلى وللآخرة خير لك من الأولى ولسوف يعطيك ربك فترضى ألم يجدك يتيما فآوى ووجدك ضالا فهدى ووجدك عائلا فأغنى فأما اليتيم فلا تقهر وأما السائل فلا تنهر وأما بنعمة ربك فحدث.
صدق الله العظيم. Brothers and sisters, today we mark the 22nd day of Shahr Rabi' al-Awwal, the month where the best of creation was born, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As we are leaving this month, we continue to celebrate his birth sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, contemplating today on this surah, Surah Al-Duha. هذه السورة بموضوعها وتعبيرها ومشاهدها وظلالها وإيقاعها لمسة من حنان ونسمة من رحمة وطائف من ود ويد حانية تمسح على الآلام والمواجع وتنسم بالروح والرضا والأمل وتسكب البرد والطمأنينة واليقين. And sisters, this surah of Ad-Duha, in its subject matter, expression, images, connotations, and rhythm, provides a touch of tenderness and mercy. It is a message of affection, the touch of benevolent hand to soothe pain and remove hardship. At the same time, it generates an air of contentment and confident hope. This surah is dedicated in entirety to the Prophet ﷺ. Its message from his Lord, which touches his heart with pleasure, joy, tranquility, and contentment. Brothers and sisters, all in all, it extends mercy and compassion to his restless soul and suffering heart. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam lived a righteous life that won him the respect of his own people of Quraysh, even those who didn't believe in him before the revelation came to him. He sallallahu alaihi wasallam walked the path of meaning and the path of spiritual transformation by frequently secluding himself in the cave of Hira. He spent days and nights in the dark night of the cave, not knowing who he was, what his place in the universe, what will come to be with him and his future prophecy and revelation that is coming, him not aware of it. But he was there in seclusion, praying the way he knew how to pray. But when he reached the age of 40, he received the revelation and the message of Al-Quran through angel Gabriel by the word read, iqra. This experience was both frightening for him as a new experience, but also soothing as his wife Khadija radiallahu anha stood by his side, comforted him, and believed in him when nobody did. And this expression, actually, the Prophet said this expression, that Khadija believed in me when nobody did. I mean, Aisha, the wife of the Prophet, al-Mu'mineen, asked the Prophet one time, you always talk about Khadija, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have given you better. He said, no, by Allah, he did not. Khadija stood with me, believed in me when nobody did. When he went in the opening of Mecca, when he went back to Mecca the first time, he asked that his tent be put near the grave of Khadija radiallahu anha. That is the love he had for this great woman. After this position that Khadija had taken and this standing, who dare today to still say that women don't have an important role in Islam? Or somebody saying that women can't take positions of leadership? Or that women cannot take high spiritual and intellectual grounds? And of course, the women of Islam and the leaders, women in Islam, are countless. But sisters, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, this was his situation when he got the revelation the first time. He was frightened, but he was consoled by his wife Khadija radiallahu anha, who supported him not just in this revelation and his encounter, but she was financially supporting him in all aspects. Well, sister, after enjoying the company of Jibreel and the closeness to his Lord, Prophet was receiving now the revelation. He was loving it. He had that regular routine encounter with Jibreel coming to bring him the revelation, getting him closer to his Lord. The revelation of the Quran to the Prophet ﷺ came at one stage to a halt, and that the angel Gabriel stopped coming to him for a while. The unbelievers said, وَدَّعَ مُحَمَّدْ رَبُّهُ. Muhammad's Lord has bidden him farewell. He's forsaken him. That's what the unbelievers said about Prophet ﷺ. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed Surah Wadduha. But sister, the revelation that Gabriel's visit and the link with Allah were the Prophet's whole equipment along his precarious path that he was taking, conveying the message of Islam. There was his only solace in the face of hard rejection and his sole comfort against outright repudiation. They were the source from which he derived his strength to stand steadfast against the unbelievers who were intent on rebuff and refusal and on directing a wicked, vile attack against the Prophet's message and the faith he preached. So when the revelation was withheld, the source of strength for the Prophet was cut off. His life spring was sapped, and he longed for his heart's friend, Jibreel. Brothers and sisters, every believer has his or her relationship with Allah. You know, as we read Quran and we read the stories of the prophets and the stories of the righteous people, it's important for us to also ask ourselves, what's in it for me in this message of Surah Ad-Duha? It is true that Prophet was intended and addressed here specifically, but all believers could experience such disconnect with their Creator at time or the other. You know, if you all engage in acts that bring you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then at one point you feel like you just praying, just reading Quran, you don't feel it anymore. You have no spiritual impact of the routine of the worship you're doing. You are experiencing, but from different perspective, what the Prophet ﷺ experienced when the revelation stopped coming to him. But if suddenly you were engaged in all these good deeds, you know, waking up for Fajr, making it for Jama'ah if you can, engaging in recitation of the Quran and the study of the Quran and the study of his seerah of the Prophet and the study of his sunnah, and you're like energized, you're happy, you feel it, and then that stops for some reason, suddenly. So you experience a momentary headlessness, ghafla, and you felt away from the company of Allah, that you no longer enjoy the worship. This will put you in a miserable state. You will feel something missing. And mistakenly you think, well, maybe I need more money. I need to actually open a new business or work more hours to fill up that void that we have. It has nothing with the worldly issues. You are being disconnected from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And nothing is going to fill up that void except coming back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فأحبابنا اختاروا المحبة مذهبا وما خالفوا في مذهب الحب شرعا فما حبنا سهل وكل من ادعى سهولته قلنا له قد جهلتنا وأيسر ما في الحب للصب قتله وأصعب من قتل الفتى يوم هجرنا. This is a little of what happened to a believer, a human believer, not a prophet, let alone to what happened to the Prophet ﷺ when the revelation, when Jibreel stopped coming to him. He ﷺ was left in the wilderness without sustenance, water, or the accustomed companionship of his beloved friend. It was a situation which heavily taxed human endurance. Then this surah was revealed and it came as a river of compassion, mercy, hope, and reassurance to the Prophet ﷺ. مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَى وَلَلْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنَ الْأُولَى وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. Your Lord has neither forsaken you, nor does he hate you. Surely the life to come will be better for you than this present life. And the Mufassirin say that your early interaction with the revelation that you had earlier, what's coming of the revelation will be even better. And of course, longer. Because the first revelation was brief. But what comes later will stay with him all his life. Yes, your Lord has never before left you or rejected you or even denied you his mercy or protection. مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَى. This kind of feeling cannot be felt except by a true believer. The feeling of forsakenness, the feeling of loss when you are disconnected from Allah. Brothers and sisters, I take you back and forth to our beloved Prophet ﷺ and his situation, and to ourselves. Because again, we have to ask, what's in it for me? What is this surah is telling me?
فَلَيْتَكَ تَحْلُو وَالْحَيَاةُ مَرِيرَةٌ وَلَيْتَكَ تَرْضَى وَالْأَنَامُ غِضَابُ وَلَيْتَ الَّذِي بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَكَ عَامِرٌ وَبَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ الْعَالَمِينَ خَرَابُ إِذَا نِلْتُ مِنْكَ الْوُدُّ فَالْكُلُّ هَيِّنٌ وَكُلُّ الَّذِي فَوْقَ التُّرَابِ تُرَابُ.
The believers must have times where he or she seeks closeness to his Lord, where we seek his forgiveness, where we beg for his bounties, for his guidance, where we put our face on the ground, cry, and ask for a glimpse of his mercy and guidance.
لا يعرف الشوق إلا من يكابده ولا الصبابة إلا من يعانيها.
Religion is not deeds only. It's not just acts of worship. That's important and has to be done. As they say, there is no belief without love. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَلَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا فَآوَى.
Has he not found you an orphan and given you a shelter?
Now, the scholars have given different meaning to this verse. And you know, the highest level of tafsir of Qur'an, commentary of the Qur'an, is the commentary of the Qur'an from the Qur'an. Tafsir al-Qur'ani bil-Qur'an. But one of the rules of tafsir al-Qur'an is the understanding of the Arabic language. When I read the commentary, the translation of the meaning, many times the translation missed the point of the verse. Because it's just a human ijtihad that somebody have understood the verse and given one aspect. I mean, it's hard. I mean, this is a call and appeal to all of you to learn the Arabic language. It's never too late. Never too late. You have not tasted the sweetness, the beauty of the word of Allah without actually engaging it with its language, Al-Arabiyya. This is not to say that you shouldn't interact with Quran while you're trying to learn. I mean, just pick on words. Just one word. Don't go like try to be an Arabic speaker. What is the meaning of orphan? أَلَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا فَآوَى. Scholars have said that the word orphan here, yatiman, translated to orphan, means that you are unique among the creation of Allah. The abilities, the attributes of the Prophet ﷺ, nobody has. So he's orphan among this humanity. Alone, like an orphan. He's like the unique pearl or gem. أَلَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا فَآوَى. Sheltered you, as it was translated. Means you were a gem that was surrounded by his companion as a shelter when they supported him. You know, anytime you have a king or you have somebody famous, you have the entourage. But the entourage of the Prophet ﷺ is like no entourage. His companions died for him, loved him more than themselves. You know, the story when he asked Umar radiallahu anhu, do you love the Prophet ﷺ? And he said, not above myself. Prophet ﷺ told him, not yet. You have not reached the level of belief. Umar, being a genuine person, doesn't fake things. He went away and came back. He say, and even I love you more than myself. He say, and now your belief is complete. I mean, how many of us can say that we put the love of Allah before ourselves? It's mainly me. And my family, and my tribe, and my party, and my hizb, before we put Allah. And found you lost and guided you, and found you poor and enriched you. So the word lost, وَوَجَدَكَ ظَالًا in Arabic language, a lot of people, even Arab, have mistaken this word, and there is different. When you look at the books of tafsir, you're going to find different meanings to this. The lost here means الغفل على ما يحصل. You're not aware of what's happening. Remember I said earlier that as he was secluding himself to Ghar Hira, he had no clue what's coming to him. Did he? He was engaged in finding the truth, in walking the path of meaning, in knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, until he got hit with this big responsibility of conveying this message. So, وَوَجَدَكَ ظَالًا means you have a lack of awareness of what's happening. That means that the Prophet was not aware that he will get the revelation. So ظَالًا means not aware of what is coming. In Arabic language, they say, مثلاً يقولوا دابة ظالة, got lost, right? But يقولوا ينشد ظالة, something that he's looking for. So the word ظالًا also means that this is the path of meaning he was seeking, the straight path. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided him to what he's looking for, to his dalla, that is to the straight path. Yuqal, they say, a lone tree in the desert, in the Sahara desert, is called shajaratun dalla, means this tree in the middle of the desert is a guide for the travelers. It's a milestone, it's a guide for the time. Means it guides people in the desert. So with that, he is sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the guide. وَوَجَدَكَ عَائِلًا فَأَغْنَى قُلْ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لِي وَلَكُمْ. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه وبعد. But the sisters, today we continue talking about Surah Al-Duha in the occasion of the month of Rabi' al-Awwal, the month of the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In this surah, Allah addressed the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and tell him, وَوَجَدَكَ عَائِلًا فَأَغْنَى. So Allah made him wealthy as he has access to all kind of wealth. Didn't Khadija radiallahu anha supported him financially as a businesswoman? He was working and she was supporting him for his cause. He did not need anything of this world. But overall, worldly material wealth was not important to him, as he was wealthy in his own self, fi nafsi, in his behavior, in his ethics. I mean, Sahaba come, Abu Bakr comes and he say, what did you bring, Abu Bakr? He say, all my wealth. What did you leave for your family? Nothing. Allah and his Prophet. That's what I left for them. Prophet ﷺ had no need for money. It's there. Sahaba, wealthy Sahaba will keep bringing money. والضحى والليل إذا سجى ما ودعك ربك وما قلى وللآخرة خير لك من الأولى ولسوف يعطيك ربك فترضى ولسوف يعطيك ربك فترضى. ما نوع العطاء؟ لقد مات إبان المعركة الدائرة مع الكفر ودفن في حجرة ملحقة بالمسجد وخرج من الدنيا وحلوائها كما تخرج الشعرة من العجين ما علق به شيء منها وترك للأوفياء من رجاله أن يمضوا على الطريق لا يعوقهم شيء فلقيت جمهرتهم الله على التوحيد والتقوى. But sisters, the surah promise more. ولسوف يعطيك ربك فترضى. And your Lord shall give you more and you shall be satisfied. What then would Muhammad be granted? He passed away at the height of Islam's struggle for survival in the face of growing opposition and was buried in a small room adjacent to his humble mosque in Medina. He left this life penniless. His successors carried the banner forward relentlessly and were shining examples of perseverance and fortitude. ثُمَّ إِنَّ اللَّهَ أَغْنَاهُ عَنِ النَّاسِ فَعَاشَ مَكْفُولَ الضَّرُورَاتِ وَلَكِنَّهُ لَيْسَ صَاحِبْ كُنُوزٍ بَلْ لَيْسَ صَاحِبُ فُضُولٍ وَبَعْدَ أَنْ ذَكَّرَهُ اللَّهُ بِنِعْمَتِهِ السَّابِقَ وَاللَّاحِقَ قَالْ فَأَمَّا الْيَتِيمَ فَلَا تَقْهَرْ وَأَمَّا السَّائِلَ فَلَا تَنْهَرْ وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ وَالتَّحْدِيثُ فَحَدِّثْ وَالتَّحْدِيثُ بِالنِّعْمَةِ كَقَوْلِهِ فِي سُورَةٍ أُخْرَى فَذَكِّرْ فَمَا أَنْتَ بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ بِكَاهِنٍ وَلَا مَجْنُونٍ. العلماء قالوا إذا سأل السائل عن العلم وجب على العالم أن يجيب وأن لا يخفي العلم. ولهذا وأما السائل يتبادر الذهن فقط المعنى الذي يطلب من الصدقة، ولكن كذلك السائل الذي يسأل عن مسائل العلم كذلك. فلا تنهر. وإنك مختار لتبليغ رسالة وإنقاذ عوالم من الناس، فحدث فلست كاهنا ولا متكلفا، إنما أنت نذير والله على كل شيء وكيل. Allah provided enough for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to live decently and comfortably, but he was not a rich emperor like many would have died. Having reminded him of Allah's grace, the surah tells Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, therefore, do not wrong the orphan, nor turn away anyone seeking help, and proclaim the blessing of your Lord. وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. And the meaning the scholars say, بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ, not to go to be boastful about your worldly belonging. Oh, I bought this house, you know. I just snatch it after the market. It has this and that. That's not what the Quran is referring to. What the Quran is referring to is that I spent a night with this surah. I was on the cloud. I felt so close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That kind of unique spiritual experiences is what people are sharing. Are the ni'am. You could talk about the other things, but these are the more important things. That it's fine to share those because maybe your friend will be envious and go and also spend the night with your surah, that surah that you've that actually enlightened you. Share that good. You get people inspired. You get people to want it to be better. اللهم اهدنا في من هديت وتولنا في من توليت وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت إنك تقضي ولا يقضى عليك وإنه لا يعز من عاديت ولا يذل من واليت تباركت ربنا وتعاليت. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما صليت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما باركت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد وأقم الصلاة.